Once again, thank you all for being here, and thank you for your kind attention. Ladies and gentlemen, announcing the arrival of the Honourable Dato' Sri Mohd Najib bin Tun Haji Abdul Razak, the Prime Minister of Malaysia, together with invited leaders and the Honourable Tun Musa Hitam, Chairman of the World Islamic Economic Forum Foundation. Honourable Prime Minister, distinguished guests, you are invited to take your seats, please. Thank you.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh, and good morning. The Honourable Dato' Sri Mohd Najib bin Tun Haji Abdul Razak, Prime Minister of Malaysia, and Her Excellency Datin Sri Rosmah Mansur, His Excellency Iki Lulu Donin, President of the Union of the Comoros, and Her Excellency Madam Hadija Abu Bakar Iki Lulu Donin, His Excellency Tharman Shanmugaratnam, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance for Singapore, and Her Excellency Mrs. Tharman, His Excellency Syed Navid Kamar, Minister, Special Representative of the President of Pakistan, His Excellency Dr. Hussein Al Abdullah, Minister, Special Representative to the Prime Minister of Qatar and Member of the Executive Board, Qatar Investment Authority, His Excellency Al-Hajj Murad Ibrahim, Chairman Moro Islamic Liberation Front, His Excellency Dr. Ahmad Muhammad Ali, President of the Islamic Development Bank, the Honourable Tun Musa Hitam, Chairman of the World Islamic Economic Forum Foundation, distinguished guests, delegates, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the World Islamic Economic Forum Foundation, we would like to bid you a warm welcome to the official opening ceremony of the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum here in Johor Bahru.
We are indeed honored and privileged to have with us here this morning the Honorable Prime Minister of Malaysia, Dato' Sri Mohamed Najib bin Tun Haji Abdul Razak, to officially open this forum today. We'd also like to extend a special welcome to the distinguished leaders and to all delegates to this forum. Ladies and gentlemen, to begin the program, may we invite Qori Haji Aziz bin Mustaqim to recite verses 10 to 13 from the Surah Al-Hujurat. Dipersilakan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنما المؤمنون إخوة فأصلحوا بين أخويكم واتقوا الله لعلكم ترحمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا يسخر قوم من قوم لا قوم من قوم عسى أن يكونوا خيرا منهم ولا نساء ولا تلمزوا أنفسكم ولا تنابزوا بالألقاب اسم الفسوق بعد الإيمان ومن لم يتب فأولئك هم الظالمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن اجتنبوا كثيرا تبوأني إذن ولا تجسس ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه واتقوا الله إن الله تواب رحيم يا عند الله أتقاكم إن الله عليم خبير صدق الله العظيم
Sadaqallahulazim. Terima kasih, thank you Tuan Haji Aziz Mustaqim. Ladies and gentlemen, it is our pleasure now to call upon the Honourable Tun Musa Hitam, Chairman of the World Islamic Economic Forum Foundation, to deliver the welcome address. Ladies and gentlemen, the Honourable Tun Musa Hitam.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and good morning. The Honourable Datuk Sri Najib Tun Razak, Prime Minister of Malaysia, His Excellency the President of the Union of Comoros, His Excellency, the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister for Finance, Republic of Singapore, His Excellency, the Minister Special Representative of the President of Pakistan, His Excellency, Minister Special Representative of the Prime Minister of Qatar and the Qatar Investment Authority, His Excellency Al-Hajj Murad, Chairman Moro Islamic Liberation Front, Mindanao, Republic of the Philippines. His Excellency Dr. Ahmad Muhammad Ali, President of the Islamic Development Bank. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the World Islamic Economic Forum Foundation, I wish to extend a warm welcome to the distinguished leaders gathered here for this 8th WIEF in Johor Bahru. I bid welcome as well to all business participants, government representatives, role players, as well as all the young participants present. Our most sincere gratitude goes to our Honorable Prime Minister of Malaysia and patron of the WIEF for his undiminished support of the foundation and for agreeing to deliver the keynote address and officially open the forum this morning. I also recognize with appreciation the presence of the Chief Minister or Menteri Besar of Johor, the Honorable Datuk Ghani Osman, as well as our founder, patron, and former Prime Minister of Malaysia, Tun Abdullah Ahmad Badawi. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, unlike previous fora, the 8th WIF this year is held with a difference. Firstly, this is the first time that we are holding it in Malaysia outside Kuala Lumpur. The choice of this historic and dynamic current state capital, that is Johor Bahru, is only logical considering economic and its economic significance within Malaysia. Johor today is going through a massive socio-economic transformation with the launching of the Iskandar Development Region. And Iskandar today is already attracting very significant foreign and domestic investments in education, tourism, sports, healthcare, manufacturing, as well as infrastructure and property development. Secondly, we are delighted that two contrasting but symbolically similar, yet much sidelined countries are represented at this 8th WIEF. I'm of course referring to the Comoros and Mindanao, each led by their most distinguished leaders. And we bid you a special welcome, Your Excellencies. With WIF continuously recognizing the special needs of small countries, we hope that Iskandar Malaysia could be a useful model to propel their own socio-economic development. It is also with our recognition of their special needs that business sessions are separately being organized for each of the leaders concerned. Thirdly, the forum itself is being reinvigorated, both in form and substance. For this year, we have restructured the forum by, one, reducing the ceremonial aspects so as to be more business-like. Two, incorporating the business women and young leaders forums into the main forum. Three, providing a leaner lineup of role players in each session to allow more in-depth discussion. Four, ensuring a more discussive format in the sessions without lengthy presentations by speakers. 5, introducing a new breakfast networking session to provide more networking opportunities as expected by participants. Incidentally, this new format that is being introduced, I would like to tell you, has already attracted a full house. We just could not have more people because so much enthusiastic and enthusiastically welcome. And 6, injecting a new face-to-face session involving a prominent personality to promote a more interactive dialogue at the forum. 3 new subjects are being introduced here in Johor Bahru. 1 is a subject that requires intricate, delicate treatment, that is on the subject of nanotechnology. Another is on a subject much neglected but with potential vast wealth utilization, that is waqf. And the 3rd new subject is on disaster management. On disaster management, the idea here is to make the business of business to concern itself with natural disasters rather than leaving everything to governments to deal with them. Ladies and gentlemen, the WIEF is not only the annual forum, even though I can proudly tell you that so far we have never failed to get tremendous crowd. And I would like to take the opportunity here to say in front of you, Mr. Prime Minister, Mr. President, and others, that Johor Bahru holds some records. 1, we have never seen so many countries represented. 86 countries are represented among you. 2, we did not expect business participation to be big. I was very unambitious, saying that if we could achieve Kuwait's objective of 800, okay, we would be happy. And the Menteri Besar has given assurance, okay, you can have more of that. But I never expected it to be. Over 800 business people from all over. And a total of over 2,000, which we've never expected Johor Bahru to host such a big event. It is actually the in-between and side events that are spreading our name far and wide in the name of the WIEF. To begin with, our roundtable events have been well received wherever they have been held. In Moscow, in Istanbul, in Bahrain, in Dhaka, in London, and in Johannesburg. Very well received and very well attended. And more requests are coming to us to conduct these sessions. The Women Entrepreneur Sessions that focus on small and medium enterprises had been overwhelmed in support. The last one being held, can you imagine, in Nairobi. And of course, this was, again, very well received. And word is spreading in Africa that many of them are requesting us to conduct similar events. Of course, among the youth, the activities of the youth, as represented by the ever popular, what is known as Marketplace of Creative Arts, is held each time we hold our annual forum, as well as in between events. Very little known, But now I'm making it known, and I hope you would have the privilege, give us the privilege of attending and supporting these events, which is very meaningful to the young and to women. And these marketplace events have attracted such a wealth of artistic talent, especially among the young. These were well illustrated by the experiences gained in Kazakhstan, in Singapore, and in Bandung, beside Kuala Lumpur. Again, requests are being made for us to have in different parts of the world. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we have chosen changing trends, new opportunities as a theme for the year's forum to reflect the current reality affecting the global economy. Changing economic trends is happening even as we speak, affecting the developed or developing countries, Muslim or non-Muslim. A great challenge for most of us is not to fear change or changing trends themselves, but to have the capacity, to have the competency, and to have the innovativeness as well as the resources to buckle the trends into new opportunities. And this is what the theme is all about. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, let me not forget to congratulate and thank all those who had contributed to the success of the 8th WAF that it evidently seems to be. The federal government and all its departments and agencies, the Johor state government and all its departments and agencies, the young volunteers, the role players, my fellow international advisory panel members, the press, correspondents, and everyone and anyone who had worked so tirelessly. Last but not least, our very hard-working secretariat staff headed by Tan Sri Fuzi and Dato Syed, thank you and congratulations. May God bless us all. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Tun Musa Hitam, for the opening and welcome remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great honor and pleasure that we now invite the Honorable Dato Sri Mohammad Najib bin Tun Haji Abdul Razak, the Prime Minister of Malaysia, to deliver the keynote address and thereafter to officially open the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum. Ladies and gentlemen, the Prime Minister of Malaysia.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera dan salam satu Malaysia. Your Excellencies, Yang Amat Berbahagia Tun Musa Hitam, Chairman of the Forum, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen. Alhamdulillah, with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're gathered here in Johor Bahru to attend the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to this significant event, not only for the Ummah, but also in terms of our engagement with the world. I would like to make a special mention of the presence of His Excellency, the President of the Union of Comoros, Mr. Ikililu Dunin. And as you can imagine, coming all the way to Comoros, it's a bit of an adventure get here to Johor Bahru. So thank you Excellency for making that effort. I would also like to thank each and every one of the leaders here in their own special way, who certainly add value to this forum. I would also like to thank my predecessor, Tun Abdullah Badawi, for his continued support and his presence at this forum. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I must confess the last time I spoke here in Johor, the audience was somewhat different. How shall I put it? Perhaps more energetic, more spirited. But you should not feel too bad. After all, it was the opening of Asia's first Legoland. So the average age was somewhat lower. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, as we gather here today, the world faces enormous challenges. And it's almost a cliche to say so. The global macroeconomic outlook continues to be weak and uncertain. Pockets of prosperity enjoyed by a few countries provide little positive impact on the economic growth of the rest. The US economic recovery is still very fragile, with no convincing solution to the Eurozone crisis in sight and poor growth. EU member states are suffering extended austerity measures and even threats of separatism. China and India are both experiencing an economic slowdown, albeit by their rather lofty standards. Countries affected by the Arab Spring, or as some prefer to call it, Arab Awakening, have yet to complete their much-needed reform to meet the growing expectations of their people. And few bright economic sparks are visible in Africa and Latin America. Of course, ASEAN as a whole is outperforming the rest of the world. Amidst the global gloom, developing Muslim countries continue to bear a heavy burden. Many are at the receiving end of policy decisions, with little or no power to influence the global economic agenda. Within such societies, often it is young people who bear the brunt of this inequality. Even in more prosperous countries, evidence suggests young people feel they do not have control over their own economic future. So today I want to talk about the young people. I want to talk about youth and opportunity in Islamic economies. I want to talk about changes facing young Muslims across the world and the hidden wealth of young nations, about the power of economic and political reform to give young people the opportunity they aspire to, and about the challenges we must confront to unlock the true potential of the Ummah. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, throughout history, Islamic societies have managed major trade routes and vital trade centers. During the Golden Age, Muslim traders established the Islamic Empire and the Arabic language as the predominant forces in world trade. The Ottoman, Safavid, and Mughal empires were economic powerhouses. And over the last century, research shows Islam has been good for growth. Witness Turkey's rapid development or Indonesia's sustained expansion. If Islam was corrosive to growth, Malaysia's economy would not have expanded on an average compound annual growth rate of 5.8% since 1991. Islamic states are capable not just of economic dynamism, but also of financial innovation, from forward markets to microfinance. Islamic societies have long been at the cutting edge of capitalism. So Islam is not and never a barrier to economic development, nor is it a barrier to vibrant democracy. As scholars have noted, Islamic doctrine shows clear democratic thought, recognition of the equality of all believers, development of consultative rule, protection of private property, establishment of justice, celebration of learning, and tolerance of faith. And yet, as we saw in Arab Awakening, many young people cannot see opportunities for themselves. They do not feel they have control over their lives or a stake in their nations. Such pessimism can lead to disengagement, radicalism, or emigration. While political freedom is important, it is economic opportunity that young people value most. We are losing some of our young people to apathy and extremism. Our challenge then is to grasp the nature of opportunity, to understand what young people in Muslim societies aspire to, so we can help them achieve. To do so, we must understand the changes affecting their lives. So what are these changes? The first is demographic. The Muslim world is experiencing a significant youth bulge. In 2010, 60% of Muslims were under the age of 30. By 2030, Muslims will make up 26% of the world's population, but 30% of its youth. What are the implications of this shift? In economic terms, a younger population brings greater pressures to bear on education and creates a bigger labor force. That in turn requires high investment in capital to utilize the spare capacity. Young people who cannot find work erode family spending power and government finances. Further down the line, a big demographic change can warp fiscal policy for decades, as baby boomer countries are discovering. But in social terms, the short-term impact can even be greater. A youth bulge introduces latent energy into a nation's economy and society. But if it is not tapped, it can become a destabilizing force. Work brings fulfillment, the feeling of playing an active part in society and contributing to the community. It also develops personal skills, self-esteem, discipline that are the requisite for success in a competitive world. But with time on their hands and no prospects for employment, a generation of people growing up with a knowing that fulfillment of those skills. In 2010, youth unemployment in the Middle East was 25%. In North Africa, 24%. employment at such levels is toxic. When young people lack opportunity, they grow restless and disenfranchised. Often, sadly, it is more educated youth who miss out. The longer they are unemployed, the harder it is to find work. Careers are blunted as people take low-paid jobs. Young people are most likely to be part of the working poor. Many put off starting a family without a decent job. They cannot marry. And so they remain frustrated, unable to fully transition to adulthood, and denied their independence. Dependency robs these young people of their dignity. With no economic stake in society, they can lose their sense of belonging. They can spill over into hostility to the state and the institutions that sustain it. From 1970 to 2000, 8 out of 10 of the countries experiencing new civil conflict had populations where 60% were under 30, just as the Muslim world does today. Muslim youth want economic opportunity. Our response must be to commit to building open and sustainable economies with education and economic reform that allows our young people to pursue their ambition. But to understand how these ambitions are framed, we must also understand the second great change in young people's lives, namely technology. 21 years ago, there were no websites. Today, there are more than 500 million. In the space of one lifetime, the internet has gone from a tiny scientific community into one of the most potent development tools the world has ever known. The internet revolution has changed the way we think about knowledge, opening up opportunities that previously seemed inconceivable. The age of information has its own generation. The digital natives, those who have only ever known a connected world, there are children leaving school today now who do not remember life before the internet. The expectations they have of access to information and freedom to communicate are completely different. They do not understand closed systems or one-way government. They expect information to be free, democracy to be responsive, and communication to be global. They want to play an active role in a digital economy. And if they are not satisfied, they will not hesitate to tell the world in a heartbeat. Great leaps in communication technology often foreshadow democratic developments. It has proved with mobile, internet, and social media. Empowered by technology and emboldened by example, young people are able to compare the strengths and weaknesses of their democracies and articulate their political needs to a global audience. Modern youth and modern aspiration is indeed borderless. This technological shift has implications for the economic sphere in which Muslim youth operate, but its political implications are greater still. We must understand and respond to the emergence of a new cross-border political consciousness. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, these two forces, demography and technology, determine the nature of opportunity for our youth. Socially and economically, young people in Islamic societies want freedom. But it is not the freedom my father's generation fought for. Freedom from colonial oppression. That's what they fought for. In an age of self-determination and development, the present generation, the young people, want freedom, freedom of opportunity. They want a world-class education. They want the freedom to pursue the options it brings. They want to be active participants in new digital spaces. They want strong democratic institutions, and they demand for more open and accountable government. And they want to play their part in civil society to build a better nation with their own hands. Our challenge, therefore, is to stretch ourselves to deliver those very freedom without sacrificing our legacy, our tradition, stability, or growth. By responding to the changes they face, we can engage Muslim youth with a clear vision of their future and harness their untapped potential for the benefit of all. But this will require both leadership and reform. First, we must focus on education, the right type of education. Although access is improving, young people find that their qualifications do not match the opportunities available in a job market. We need a greater emphasis on vocational and technical training and on standards and outcomes to ensure that learning unlocks opportunity rather than closing it off. We must also continue to open up our economies. Each country in the Muslim world faces its own strengths and challenges. But as a general principle, we must build a more dynamic marketplace and a stronger, more robust private sector. We must boost our share of world trade. 23% of the world's population are Muslim, but OIC nations conduct just a mere 8.3% of global trade. We have the headroom, we have the capacity. It is simply a matter of opening our economies. In so doing, we can make our nations more competitive, bringing high-value jobs and stronger growth. We should pursue structural reforms to ensure that our economies can compete in the industries of the future. Here, the youth are our guide. Surveys show that Muslim youth identify the digital economy and green technology as significant in demand sectors where they ought to have a natural advantage. We must also respond to technological change, recalibrating the way we think about government, the way we communicate with young people. Our starting point must be recognition of the fundamental principle of the internet, its autonomy. The internet thrives because it exists outside the control of one state or authority. It should remain that way. This does not mean unregulated behavior, but independence. We should preserve the online space in which the free exchange of views is encouraged in the best traditions of discourse. We should open our minds to new opportunities in the digital economy. As microfinance and mobile banking has shown, the ability to manage money on the move helps young people gain financial independence and start businesses. We should do more of our business and banking online and support our digital entrepreneurs. We must also encourage moderation and the practice of tolerance. Polls show that young Muslims want a greater role for religion in public and political life. We should show that this trust is well deserved by offering a true vision of Islam that is moderate and tolerant. And we should embrace new instruments of Islamic finance. Although here I must declare an interest, because Malaysia leads the world in the issuing of Sukuk bonds. Finally, we must be prepared to invest in all our young people, including women, whose unemployment numbers are consistently 10% higher than men. We must put our confidence in Muslim youth as full economic participants, as consumers, employees, and entrepreneurs. And we must be unafraid to encourage change in institutions which stifle young people's opportunities, reforming public services, supporting appointment by merit, and remain ever vigilant against corruption. Today, these changes will help us capitalize on our greatest resource, our youth. It is up to us to show leadership and build economies that are prepared for the future. We must be willing to confront old assumptions and embrace new technologies to open up our economies and reform our politics. This will not always be easy. There will be challenges. There will be uncertainties. But believe me, reform is necessary. And history shows us that it is right. The periods of greatest Islamic influence were the most intellectually open. Ladies and gentlemen, as a developing country committed to economic reform, Malaysia has faced some hard choices already. We know we must improve public service delivery and offer new opportunities to meet the growing expectations of our people. The World Islamic Economic Forum will explore these issues. The focus on nurturing the potential of our young entrepreneurs and business leaders is commendable, and I'm confident the sessions on democratization of education and the role of technology will be fascinating. So, let me leave you with one thought. I believe we should see our youth not as a liability, but as an asset, an untapped resource that will allow us to develop and modernize. Managed properly, this resource can lay the foundations for greater success. By focusing on economic and political reform, we can present a compelling vision of a future defined by opportunity, not dependency. In so doing, I'm sure we can bring young people into the fold, giving them a meaningful stake in society. It is not only a powerful safeguard against disenfranchisement and extremism, it is also our opportunity to make this the greatest Muslim generation that has ever lived. I thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Ladies and gentlemen, that marks the official opening of the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum. Thank you, Honourable Prime Minister. Ladies and gentlemen, we now like to invite the Honourable Dato' Sri Mohamed Najib Tun Abdul Razak, the Prime Minister, to moderate the special address by the leaders. With that, I hand over the floor to the Honourable Prime Minister.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to moderate this special address by leaders session at this auspicious 8th WIEF this morning. As I mentioned in my speech, we are honored to have the presence of the President of Comoros, the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance of Singapore, the Minister Special Representative of the President of Pakistan, the Minister Special Representative of the Prime Minister of Qatar, the Chairman of the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, and the President of the Islamic Development Bank. With the European markets facing an uphill battle in the Eurozone debt crisis, investors and businesses have been looking at business opportunities in other countries around the globe. So the theme of the 8th WIEF is very apt: changing trends, new opportunities. I'd like to start by inviting His Excellency, the President of Comoros. I believe the islands of Comoros is rather beautiful from what I hear. It is based predominantly on agriculture, fishing, hunting, forestry. Plantation engage a large proportion of the population in producing the island's major cash crops for export. I hope His Excellency President Ikililu Donin, the President of Comoros, will be able to share with us his views from the perspective of the African continent on the changing dynamics in global business today in the light of the Arab Spring and the Eurozone crisis, and how Comoros is addressing the situation. Excellency, you have the floor.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Honorable Dato Sri Najib Tun Abdul Razak, Premier Ministre de la Malaisie, mes chers frères. Honorable Tun Moussa Itam, Président de la Fondation OEF. Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. C'est un grand honneur et un réel plaisir pour moi de m'adresser à une distinguée audience composée d'éminentes personnalités parmi les décideurs, les hommes d'affaires, les professeurs, les universitaires et les banquiers. À cette occasion, permettez-moi tout d'abord d'exprimer à l'honorable Dato Sri Mohamed Najib bin Tun Abdul Razak, Premier ministre de la Malaisie, à son gouvernement et au peuple frère de la Malaisie, ma profonde gratitude pour l'accueil chaleureux et fraternel qui nous est réservé depuis notre arrivée dans ce magnifique beau pays. Je remercie tout particulièrement l'honorable Premier ministre ainsi que l'honorable Tun Moussa Itam, président du Forum, pour l'honneur fait à mon pays en me désignant pour prononcer un discours spécial à l'occasion de cette importante assise. Distingués invités, mesdames et messieurs, la présence de nombreuses délégations venues des grands pays frères de l'Union des Comores à ce 8e forum mondial sur les économies des pays islamiques consacré cette année aux tendances nouvelles et opportunités nouvelles témoigne l'importance accordée à ce thème dans un contexte de crise économique mondiale. Ce grand événement se tient en effet à un moment où l'économie mondiale est fortement marquée par la crise de la zone euro, présent suite à la crise américaine de subprimes qui a secoué notamment les grandes économies en 2008. Durant cette crise, les principales recommandations prônaient la régulation des marchés financiers et le contrôle des interventions des banques pour pallier aux risques élevés que ces derniers avaient tendance à prendre. Pourtant, la régulation financière ne pouvait pas à elle seule prévenir tout risque d'instabilité financière. 2 ans plus tard, le monde est de nouveau plongé dans une nouvelle crise économique née de la dette souveraine dans la zone euro. Cette situation est d'autant plus inquiétante que l'impact de cette crise s'étend sur des zones qui présentaient des taux de croissance confortables. Ainsi, les perspectives à venir ne sont guère rassurantes. Les prévisions de croissance sont en effet revues à la baisse, même pour les pays émergents qui, pourtant, ont mieux résisté jusque-là aux effets de ces crises. C'est dans cette optique et face à cette conjoncture internationale incertaine que l'organisation de ce 8e Forum mondial sur l'économie des pays islamiques offre une belle occasion de rappeler que la finance islamique peut être une des réponses à apporter aux nombreuses incertitudes que rencontre l'économie mondiale. À cet effet, la finance islamique connaît une croissance régulière parce que sa justification économique est fondée sur le principe de ne pas priver l'économie réelle et productive de fonds et de financement. Ce système trouve un écho de plus en plus important dans le monde, y compris occidental, qui en manifeste un intérêt constant. Il est donc nécessaire de renforcer la coopération sur cet espace économique constitué par le monde musulman afin que la finance islamique devienne un instrument de développement économique de nos pays. Je ne vais pas rappeler ici devant un auditoire composé d'éminents spécialistes de la finance islamique que la nature même de la finance islamique constitue un bouclier contre une exposition excessive, conférant ainsi à l'économie un degré de sécurité bien plus élevé. Mon propos vise plutôt à encourager les décideurs politiques que nous sommes à accélérer davantage les réformes visant à permettre à la finance islamique de l'intégrer pleinement dans la mondialisation financière. Honorables invités, mesdames et messieurs, pour ce qui concerne mon pays, l'Union des Comores, mon gouvernement a initié une nouvelle dynamique afin de relancer le développement du pays. Il s'est notamment engagé dans un programme avec le Fonds monétaire international avec l'objectif d'atteindre le point d'achèvement avant la fin de cette année et de bénéficier d'un allègement et d'une annulation de la dette. Par ailleurs, l'ouverture du secteur bancaire à la concurrence a permis l'implantation de 2 nouvelles banques à capitaux étrangers et le développement accéléré d'institutions de microfinance qui participent à l'inclusion financière. Cette volonté d'ouverture s'est aussi orienté vers l'ouverture de la finance islamique. J'ai en effet demandé aux autorités compétentes, la Banque centrale en particulier, de s'approcher à la Banque islamique de développement en vue d'inscrire l'intégration de la finance islamique dans la sphère financière des Comores. Je saisis par conséquent cette occasion pour appeler nos frères du Golfe et d'Asie à venir en partenaire insuffler cette dynamique de la finance islamique dans mon pays. Je les invite à venir contribuer à favoriser le développement socio-économique, notamment en favorisant la création de la banque spécialisée dans ce domaine. Je saisis également cette opportunité pour appeler les investisseurs, en particulier ceux des pays musulmans, à venir investir davantage dans mon pays, à l'instar de l'Émirat du Qatar. Je voudrais à ce propos renouveler ici la gratitude du gouvernement et du peuple comorien à l'endroit de mon frère, Son Altesse Cheikh Ahmad bin Khalifa Al Thani, émir du Qatar, pour tout le soutien moral, technique et financier que le Qatar apporte à mon pays. Honorables invités, mesdames et messieurs, en matière d'investissement, l'Union des Comores dispose d'instruments juridiques tels que le nouveau Code des investissements adopté en 2007, qui offre un cadre réglementaire largement favorable aux investissements directs étrangers. Par ailleurs, l'Agence nationale pour la promotion des investissements a été mise en place pour faciliter les démarches liées à la création d'entreprises avec des dispositions incitatives. Je voudrais souligner ici qu'aux Comores, beaucoup de secteurs présentent des potentialités non négligeables en matière d'investissement. Le tourisme est insuffisamment exploité, alors que notre archipel présente des caractéristiques naturelles rares et pas assez valorisées, avec la richesse de ses paysages et ses fonds marins uniques. Les Comores disposent également d'importantes ressources halieutiques avec une grande variété de poissons. Ce secteur de la pêche, qui est encore au stade embryonnaire aux Comores, offre de vastes possibilités d'investissement. Je ne peux ne pas mentionner également, pour ce qui est des atouts du pays, l'accueil chaleureux et légendaire du pays comorien, du peuple comorien, ainsi que la paix et la stabilité qui règnent dans notre pays. À l'instar de beaucoup de nos pays en développement, le développement des infrastructures de base reste une priorité pour mon gouvernement. Je pense en particulier aux infrastructures routières, portuaires et aéroportuaires, aux deux secteurs sociaux qui sont l'éducation et la santé, mais aussi au secteur de l'eau et de l'énergie qui sont primordiaux pour attirer les investissements étrangers. Il serait donc souhaitable que nous réfléchissions ensemble à la mise en place d'un mécanisme de financement multilatéral dédié aux infrastructures et qui pourrait également développer des solutions dans les autres secteurs créateurs de valeur ajoutée dans le pays musulman. Nous devrions donc tirer avantage de cet espace que nous avons en commun et de potentialités considérables pour bâtir ensemble un cadre de coopération économique fondé sur le principe du développement et de la solidarité. Je saisis cette occasion pour renouveler mes remerciements à la Fondation du Forum économique islamique mondial pour ses efforts dans son combat pour la promotion de l'entrepreneuriat féminin et des jeunes, notamment en Afrique. Distingués invités, mesdames et messieurs, le monde islamique est aujourd'hui en ébullition. Le printemps arabe et les bouleversements en cours dans de nombreux pays musulmans ainsi que les guerres civiles fratricides dans diverses régions doivent nous interpeller tous, car ils sont la manifestation des conditions socio-économiques difficiles. Aussi, pour assurer la paix et la stabilité dans nos pays et dans le monde musulman en particulier, devons-nous mettre à profit nos atouts communs pour lutter contre la pauvreté et la misère pour un développement durable et harmonieux. Je reste convaincu que la générosité et la bonne volonté, ainsi que l'engagement de chacun d'entre nous, nous permettront d'atteindre nos objectifs louables pour un monde musulman prospère. Je vous remercie.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, and you have touched on a couple of very important points, namely the huge potential in terms of the role of Islamic finance as part of the global financial architecture, and secondly, the fact that you are making the necessary reforms in the Union of Comoros to attract more investment. I'd like to thank you for your contribution. The next speaker, it gives me great pleasure to invite His Excellency Mr. Taraman, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance of Singapore. He didn't have to travel very far to get here as compared to the President of Comoros, but nonetheless, the strategic importance of Singapore in terms of its preeminent role as a hub of commercial and investment activities in the region, and in our case, Singapore being our immediate neighbor, the synergistic relationship between our two countries, particularly between Singapore and Johor and Iskandar development, is indeed of much importance to us. And I'd like to share the conversation I had with Prime Minister Chen Lung in Phnom Penh recently. We talked about the future between our two countries, and we both concluded that Singapore can be the Manhattan, like New York, and Johor will be the New Jersey. So I don't mind, we don't mind me New Jersey, because we have all the lovely bungalows here. And just a selling point, for a quarter of the cost of properties in Singapore, you can have a bungalow with swimming pool here. So that should be quite an attraction. So on that note, can I invite Mr. Taraman to make this presentation?
Prime Minister of Malaysia, His Excellency Dato Sri Najib Razak, President of Comoros, His Excellency Ikili Liu Duinin, President of Islamic Development Bank, His Excellency Ahmad Muhammad Ali, Chairman of the World Islamic Economic Forum Foundation, Tun Musa Itam, ministers, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Salam sejahtera saya ucapkan kepada para tetamu terhormat dan hadirin sekalian. It is my real privilege to have been invited to join Prime Minister Najib, Tun Musa, and all the other dignitaries who are here. I must immediately confess that it took me a little shorter to get here than it does for me to get to work on a normal day. And there are several implications arising from that. But let me first congratulate the WIF on the progress it has made in a very short period of time, progress it's made in just 9 years. In establishing itself as a leading international forum for economic leaders and opinion makers from a very broad range of countries. to discuss issues concerning Islamic finance as well as other related issues in the world of finance. It is an achievement. The theme of the forum, as Prime Minister Najib has mentioned, is particularly relevant, changing trends, new opportunities. And allow me to say a few things first by way of perspective on the current challenges and opportunities facing Islamic finance, before going on to talk about some of the broader issues that emerging market economies face in this new global environment. In the aftermath of the global financial crisis, new challenges, especially with regard to managing capital flows. The Islamic finance industry, I think we all know, has been growing rapidly. It's been growing by something like 19% per year since 2006. But there's still considerable scope left on this journey of developing Islamic finance. To illustrate, Islamic finance presently forms less than 1% of the global financial industry. For a large number of countries, even in jurisdictions with substantial Muslim populations, Islamic finance currently constitutes less than 5% of their financial sectors. And despite a record level of sukuk issuance in 2012, the industry as a whole is still largely concentrated on the banking sector. So it's largely banking activity thus far. There is much ahead in the journey to develop Islamic capital markets and the takaful industry. I believe the next 10 to 15 years offer significant opportunities for the growth and diversification of Islamic finance. And let me highlight the reasons to be optimistic about its prospects. First, Islamic financial institutions have in the main escaped significant damage in the global financial crisis. They are well placed to grow at a time when many of the global banks, especially the European banks, are deleveraging or focusing on consolidating their balance sheets. So that's the first reason. Secondly, Islamic finance has much potential to diversify into new growth areas, such as trade and infrastructure financing in Asia and the emerging markets. These new areas will allow Islamic banks to reduce their exposure to the real estate sector and to take advantage of the strong growth potential of the emerging market economies. There are gaps to be filled in structured trade finance and in funding for infrastructural projects as the emerging markets grow and as global finance consolidates. A third reason is that Islamic finance can also seek to meet the increased demand for simpler and more transparent products, or if you like, back to basics finance. Investors are now much more circumspect about complex products and their risks. The crisis taught investors worldwide not only about the damage they can face from the risks that are known and unsurprising, but of the risks of what we do not know. Islamic finance, with its focus on transparency, price certainty, and risk sharing, can ride this wave of demand for simpler and more basic investments. So those are three structural reasons in the new environment why Islamic finance has promise for significant growth in the years ahead. And I believe this will not just be a short spurt of 3 or 4 years, but it will be a 10 to 15 year opportunity. However, Islamic finance will have to overcome a few important challenges in order to grow its share in global finance and to contribute especially to cross-border finance. These challenges include the need to reduce fragmentation in Islamic financial markets due to differences in accepted standards of Sharia compliance between regions, jurisdictions, and in some cases even domestically within jurisdictions. This has hampered the flow of liquidity between jurisdictions and is in part why there is, as yet, no Islamic equivalent to the international money and bond markets. But there is considerable progress that is being made to to address these challenges. Bodies such as the IDB's Islamic Research and Training Institute and Malaysia's International Sharia Research Academy, or ISRA, have made significant efforts to narrow the differences in acceptability of Sharia compliance. And there are several other bodies, the IFSB, in conjunction with the international standard-setting bodies like the BIS for banking, IOSCO for securities, the IAIS for insurance industry, and various regulators from both Islamic and conventional jurisdictions, are formulating international standards and best practices for the industry. Another positive trend is what's happening in Asia. Islamic finance is also seeing increasing interest in Asia. We are seeing financial institutions leveraging on the strengths and expertise that have been developed in both Islamic and conventional financial markets. And this is a very important new trend, the way in which we're leveraging an expertise in both Islamic and conventional finance. It is expanding the range of Sharia-compliant products and allowing the Islamic finance industry to tap on broad and deep investor pools globally and in Asia. Malaysia is, of course, widely recognized as a leader in Islamic finance, and particularly for the issuance of sukuks. Islamic finance is also growing in other Asian financial centers, such as Singapore, Hong Kong, and Tokyo. Just recently, in the middle of last month, mid-November 2012, institutional and private investors in Singapore and Hong Kong were the largest investors in the $15.5 billion global sukuk issued by the Abu Dhabi Islamic Bank, or ADIB, just as an example. Between our two countries, Malaysia and Singapore, we are seeing Malaysian banks collaborating with Singapore corporates and financial players to structure Singapore dollar denominated corporate sukuk programs. And Singapore listed companies are venturing out to tap the ringgit sukuk market in Malaysia. These are trends which we are keen to encourage. To repeat, therefore, I'm optimistic that we can realize the significant growth potential for Islamic finance in the next 10 to 15 years. Let me move on now to say a few things about the second area in which a new global environment is shaping new trends and challenges in finance. And that has to do with the challenges that many in the emerging world face in managing capital flows, particularly in the face of extremely low interest rates being set in the advanced economies. We are in an unprecedented situation. Interest rates are expected to stay extremely low in the US and much of the advanced world for a few years, not just for a few quarters, for a few years, reflecting decisions by their central banks to keep monetary conditions highly accommodative until their economies resume normal growth. There is debate amongst economists on how effective these activist monetary policies, such as the US Fed's QE3 strategy, will be in reviving entrepreneurial spirits and private investments. If the strategy succeeds and the US economy recovers, it will be a plus for Asia as well. In the meantime, however, there are significant implications for emerging market economies as global investors search for better returns than the near zero rates that they get on cash and treasury bills. With large amounts of liquidity now moving between markets, short-term shifts in investor sentiment lead to volatility in capital flows. We have seen how a shock in the European periphery can send money that was invested in emerging markets rushing back to the United States or other safe havens. To be clear about it, there is a lot that is good about capital flows, including even short-term flows. They add liquidity to markets by bringing more buyers and sellers together. However, we know too well that capital flows can also be too much of a good thing. They can lead to asset prices or exchange rates becoming disconnected from fundamentals. And the sudden withdrawal of capital from emerging economies when investors switch from risk on to risk off in their portfolios can be destabilizing. As I mentioned, the current global environment is unprecedented. The policy responses in the advanced countries too
are without precedent. Globally, therefore, we need some humility in understanding the benefits and costs of QE3 and easy monetary policies in the advanced economies. But it will be wise to strengthen our policy toolkits in Asia so that we can deal with unpredictable and often excessive capital flows. There are some lessons that come out of our experiences in Asia and elsewhere, and policy responses that we can learn from each other. I will mention three sets of policy responses that will inevitably have to figure in our toolkits. First, there is much sense in curtailing volatility in the exchange rate over the short term. The costs of volatile and uncertain exchange rates are high in small open economies especially, which is what most of our ASEAN economies are. Accordingly, Malaysia, Singapore, and several other Asian countries have not felt comfortable leaving their exchange rates entirely to market forces. Their central banks, within each of their monetary policy frameworks, have sought to instill a focus on longer-term fundamentals. There is merit in allowing exchange rates in Asia, Asia's emerging economies, to appreciate gradually over the long term, reflecting their more rapid growth. If we resist these long-term trends, we are likely to see more inflation in our economies. But some stability in the short term is wise. Second policy response and second policy lesson is that macroprudential policies are now an important part of the policy toolkit. Many Asian countries have introduced new macroprudential measures to try and avoid bubbles in their property markets, especially over the last 2 years. Malaysia brought in stricter limits on loan-to-value ratios on housing loans. Singapore and Hong Kong have done similarly and have introduced additionally stamp duties or transaction taxes to discourage speculative demand for residential properties. These targeted administrative and prudential measures are not conventional macroeconomic tools, but they are likely to remain part of our policy toolkit, at least for the foreseeable future, given the real risks to macroeconomic stability that an environment of very low global interest rates poses. A third and more fundamental strategy has to focus on building greater depth in Asia's capital markets while ensuring that our banking systems remain sound. A good example of this strategy is in fact Malaysia. Bank Negara's Financial Sector Blueprint 2, released as part of the government's economic transformation program, will build on the solid foundations of Malaysia's financial system, including developing a deep and vibrant bond market. The banks in several leading Asian countries, including Malaysia and Singapore, are generally well managed and well capitalized. They were a source of strength for us during the global financial crisis. However, Asia's capital markets, and especially the corporate bond markets, need much more depth. Broader and deeper capital markets will allow investors to invest for the long term while hedging against risks. And even long-term investors need hedging instruments, and they need depth in hedging markets. The capital markets, deeper capital markets, will therefore help us meet the growing infrastructural and other long-term investment needs of the region. This is therefore a very important priority in the region, and there is in fact significant scope for future development of Asian capital markets. Regulators are working to harmonize rules and market practices across the region, such as issuance procedures and settlement standards. We also need to develop the securitization markets with appropriate safeguards so that banks can recycle their capital. More too is being done to boost linkages between our markets and economies. And I mentioned one example, which is quite recent, which is how the Malaysian Stock Exchange, Bursa Malaysia, the Singapore Exchange, and the Stock Exchange of Thailand have recently launched an ASEAN trading link. We are also cooperating to encourage financing of infrastructure projects in the region. The ASEAN Infrastructure Fund, an initiative that was led by Malaysia, is a good example. It will pool resources, knowledge, and expertise amongst ASEAN governments and the Asian Development Bank for loans to sovereign or sovereign-guaranteed infrastructure projects. The fund will also issue bonds so as to bring in private sector and institutional investors. Another example of such cooperation in the Asian region is the Credit Guarantee and Investment Facility that was launched by the ASEAN Plus 3 countries, which helps companies, private companies in ASEAN Plus 3 countries to raise long-term financing for infrastructure investment by providing government guarantees on their corporate bonds, thereby reducing risk for bondholders. Projects like Iskandar Malaysia, which Prime Minister Najib has highlighted, are also a prime example of how intra-regional investments can be encouraged and how countries in our region can develop competitive strengths jointly. Iskandar Malaysia's performance has been impressive. It is poised to exceed its target of $100 billion investments by the end of this year. I'm glad there's good progress in the joint venture by Temasek Holdings at Khazanah National, Pulau Indah Ventures, Sdn. Berhad, to co-develop two separate sites in Medini. Other significant projects include the $1.5 billion Singapore dollar integrated eco-friendly tech park by Ascendas and Malaysia's UEM Land Berhad in Nusa Jaya. Once completed, this park will accommodate a range of industries including electronics and precision engineering. And just in the last month, we have seen other significant investment commitments in Iskandar, reported by Singapore companies. Iskandar Malaysia will enhance the complementary space between our two economies. It is a win-win. To ensure continued progress in Iskandar, Singapore and Malaysia will continue to take steps to improve connectivity, cross-border trade facilitation, and immigration processes. I would like to conclude by emphasizing once again that I'm basically optimistic about the prospects in our bilateral and regional cooperation. We face many challenges in this post-global financial crisis era. But the opportunities for us in Asia are intact, and our ability to cooperate with each other to achieve our full potential as a region is an asset for all our countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Excellency Mr. Tharman. He has expressed a great deal of confidence about the potential of Islamic finance, at the same time touching on some of the challenges that we face. The point that is very important for us to note is that in the midst of us facing this global financial crisis and Eurozone debt problem, the imperative for us to deepen our cooperative networking between countries, particularly in the region, is much more essential than ever before, and the prospects are simply quite enormous, as was mentioned. Not the least, the development between Singapore and Iskandar region, and there are very exciting projects, as was mentioned. And the other point that was made by Prime Minister Sian Lung is that the trend of more Singaporeans living in Johor and commuting to Singapore on a daily basis is taking shape. And it goes to show that if you get the economics right, then borders become somewhat insignificant. So I'd like to thank you for your contribution. Can I now invite His Excellency Mr. Syed Navid Kamar, Minister, Special Representative for the President of Pakistan, to make his presentation. Excellency, you have the floor.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much. Bismillahir Rahman Rahim. Excellency Datuk Seri Najib Tun Abdul Razak. Excellency the President of Comoros. Excellency Tun Musa Hitam, chairman of the World Islamic Economic Forum, ministers, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great honor and pleasure for me to represent my country by participating in this eighth meeting of the World Islamic Economic Forum in this beautiful and growing city of Johor Bahru, which has laid out the red carpet for us since our arrival last night. The participation of leaders from around the region who may be just commuting to work or take a very, very complex route all the way from Comoros up to Johor represents the length and breadth of the interest that people in general have, but particularly the leadership, both corporate as well as political, have in the vast potential of the Islamic population and the potential that it provides for the future of the world. I must commend that this forum during the span of last 8 years have come to the center stage of global debate in shaping and evolving clear and concrete agendas for the emerging Muslim countries. It has also succeeded in helping forge informal business interaction, networking, and regional consultation. For this, I take this opportunity to specially commend the key role and sagacious stewardship of His Excellency Tun Musa Hitam, the chairman of this forum, as well as the leadership of Malaysia. I feel great pleasure to note that Pakistan has been contributing to the impressive work and activities of the forum. We had the privilege and honor to host in November 2006 the second meeting of the forum, which was an important milestone in setting direction for the forum's future agenda and evolving strategies for creating better understanding of the business opportunities and integration with the global economy. Today, it's quite heartening to see the forum has expanded outreach to encompass other important groups of the society, including the women and youth. We are confident that the forum will inspire further the women business entrepreneurs and the youth to work in making their impressive marks in the field of business and trade. I must say, Excellency, that your remarks regarding harnessing the youth and the potential they present, not only globally, but individually in our own countries, has to be seen in the perspective in which it was presented. Obviously, Pakistan today, while on the one hand realizing this potential by the huge workforce that we have sent around the world, where it is performing miracles, is also facing the problems of terrorism within our own country, based on the fact that we have not been able to fully harness the potential of these youth. So the way this issue can be channelized can either lead to enormous growth in our countries or lead to the peril of the world. And we, both individually as well as collectively, have to set out policies which will ensure that it is channeled in the right direction. We believe that the time has come to practically realize the ideas and strategies that have been debated and agreed in the previous seven forums. We must now enter the phase of utilizing our rich human capital, immense resources, political determination for achieving this economic growth. We are one-fifth of the humanity, but our economic performance has yet to catch up with this large and growing size and influence that we are having on the rest of the world. We have yet to exploit the new economic environment to our advantage, in which, of course, the private sector has to play a lead role, and the governments have to provide the framework in which the private sector can play this role. We have not started to benefit from the expansion of global trade, massive capital flows, and exchange of technologies around the world. The sooner we adjust to the ground realities of the emerging environment, the brighter our prospects of success would be. The task for us has become all the more challenging as the world is still suffering from the economic downturn, which calls for alternative and innovative ways to govern international business in a just and sustainable manner. As the previous models have failed to provide enduring solutions to running economies, the world is desperately looking for new templates. I think it is an opportunity for Muslim economies to be innovative and to provide alternate solutions. While there's a need to increase trade and business within the Muslim countries by creating strong linkages between businesses, at the same time, we must interact with other regional and international economic organizations. We, as 57 Muslim developing countries, should play a lead role in reforming the global economic architecture. Ladies and gentlemen, recently we deliberated on similar concerns at the 8th summit of the 8 Developing Muslim Countries, or D8, in Islamabad last month. We strongly believe that more business cooperation is the only way of addressing the economic and political problems. And therefore, that was the emphasis that was laid at this summit. The forging of public-private partnerships and the linkages between governments and the private sector within our own countries will certainly provide the opportunities that have proved elusive so far, but is something that, Excellency, you yourself alluded to. During that summit, a number of practical and useful recommendations were made, including establishment of trade and development banks, barter trade, promotion of the halal sector, and Islamic financing, to mention some. I believe the recipe holds true for other Muslim countries also. I also take this opportunity to propose proactive interaction between D8 and WIEF in devising development strategies. Ladies and gentlemen, there is an urgent need to work to establish a sound framework for mutual cooperation in order to broaden and deepen our economic relations, such as intra-Islamic cooperation, which is critical to ensure energy, food, and water security and sustainable development for our people. On other fora, we have been proposing a focus on education and promotion of science and technology cooperation. In this regard, the useful work of COMSTECH is certainly an example to be looked at. It is our belief that skill development is imperative to equip our industrious workforce with capabilities in demand in national and international markets. There's also a need to share our financial and commodity surpluses through institutional mechanisms. We should share our best practices and create complementarities. Our goal should be to promote unhindered flow of capital, labor, goods, and services. Excellencies, may I state that the theme of this session on setting new trends and benefiting from opportunities is timely. This is the moment to be seized, to transform the emerging economic and business opportunities to our own interests in a just and equitable manner. This prestigious forum is in the forefront in providing the strategies and modalities to achieve that objective. No doubt we have made progress in many areas, but there's a long way to go. We are sure that the Muslim world, with its rich resources and strong determination, will be able to turn the financial and economic challenges into opportunities and would establish new and beneficial trends for all in doing business, making investments, and conducting trade. We all know that we are determined in the process of achieving this goal. We assure, as a representative of government of Pakistan and its people, fullest cooperation and support in realizing these objectives. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Excellency. I believe that Pakistan, with a market size of 100 million people, has vast opportunities for business generation and investment. The only challenge is the challenge of security. Once the situation in Pakistan is much more secure, I believe that the upturn will be much more evident. Thank you, Excellency. Can I now move on to His Excellency Dr. Hussein, Minister, Special Representative of the Prime Minister of Qatar. I believe that Qatar, despite being a small nation, is having a much more significant role in terms of its presence in the world stage because of the enormous resources it has and some of the astute investment that Qatar has made around the world. And also, we'd like to congratulate Qatar for going to be the host for the World Cup in 2022, I think. So on that note, the floor is yours, Dr. Hussein.
Thank you. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Your Excellency, the Prime Minister of Malaysia, Excellencies, distinguished audience, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is a great honor for me to be with you in this economic forum. I would like to thank His Excellency, the Prime Minister of Malaysia, and the people of Malaysia for the generous hospitality and warm reception. Also, I would like to convey to you the greetings of His Excellency Sheikh Hamad bin Jassim bin Jaber Al Thani, the Prime Minister of the State of Qatar, who asked me to attend this economic forum on his behalf, because he is busy with urgent matters, and to express his best wishes and success of the forum. Before I start my presentation, I would strongly recommend to adopt the speech of the Prime Minister of Malaysia as a mission for the Islamic world. Today, I will speak about three big changes which are happening and that we need to understand them very well. The governments and companies and investors, they need to understand these structural changes in order to move forward and succeed. The first structural change is happening in the commodity or in natural resources. The risk of scarcity in natural resources expected to rise significantly, which could lead to supply instability and potential disruption in the next 10 years. Why? Because the number of population is increasing from 6.9 billion today to 9.3 billion in 2050. And 30% of this 9.3 in 2050 will be Muslim. and 30% atheist, and 40% Christians and others. Not only that, the middle class and per capita income is rising in the in Brazil, in Russia, in China, in India, and in most of the emerging market. The middle class is rising, so they will have the ability to consume more. As a result, the price of food, energy, metals will go up. I will give you an example. Demand for oil in 2010 is only 7 billion tons in 2010. In 2050, the demand of oil will rise from 7 million tons to 14 billion tons. As a result, the price will go above $200. China is shifting to be a consumer economy. That means they will consume more. China in 2021 will celebrate, the Communist Party will celebrate their 100 years. And one of their objectives is to be the largest economy. If China continues to grow today at around 7%, 7% and a half, and the U.S. is growing at 20%, China will bypass the U.S. So China is expected in 2050 to consume 50% of the natural resources on Earth. The second structural change is happening in politics. A historical shift in a human consciousness or awareness of what people will accept from the leaders, from their leaders, which is leading to the destabilization and overthrow of government. It took Gandhi's 30 years to overthrow the regime. It took the Tunisian 1 month and a half to overthrow their regime. It took Egypt only 19 days, thanks to social network, Facebook and Twitter. People now have to know. People now knows what is happening because of the internet and computer. They know what is happening around the world. So their expectation is rising. Therefore, government that fail to deliver freedom and opportunities will be overthrown. The third structural change is happening in the financial sector. More regulation. In some countries, from zero regulation to maybe 70 or 80% regulation. So we'll see more regulation is happening in the financial sector. Synthetic product will disappear gradually because of the regulation. Securitization as a form of finance is disappearing, is not there. The rule of the games is changing. The private equity fund, which leverage buyout, is not anywhere. As a business model, it's almost vanished. So Islamic finance, it will come more to the surface. Why? Because the financial sector, because of the regulation, will go back to the basic. And Islamic finance, as a result, will come to the surface because it's based on three principles. You only can trade what you own. Second principle, no risk, no reward. But the most important principles that which help the Islamic finance is that the ethics, Islamic ethics, that is which based upon, is needed these days to really to move forward and to create strong financial institution. Because financial sector and the banking sector extremely important to grow. Because without a healthy financial institution, without a sound financial institution, we will not be able to grow. Whatever macroeconomic policy, whether fiscal policy or monetary policy that we will develop. So therefore, we need to develop a harmonized standard which can be accepted by the Islamic and conventional banking community as a whole. At the end, I want to underline that the state of Qatar, according to the guidelines of our sovereign, His Highness Sheikh Hamad bin Khalifa Al Thani, is committed toward our brothers in the Islamic world to unify our visions and positions, to deepen ways of economic and social cooperation, to provide our people in the Islamic world with better education, better healthcare, better housing, better environment, more stable jobs, and moreover, more freedom and opportunities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, nicely, Dr. Hussein, for drawing our attention to three very important trends. I'd just like to say that you got it right, and this is very much in line with what speech that I made this morning, that the key is to create opportunity. And we in Malaysia believe that we don't have to change the government to create the opportunities. The same government can create opportunities. This is not a campaign mode, by the way. Thank you very much. And now we move on to a former freedom fighter who is now going to lead the new Bangsa Moro. His Excellency Alhaj Murad Ibrahim, Chairman of MILF. I'm sure he's got an interesting story to tell. The floor is yours.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, wa bihi nasta'in, wa salatu wa salam wa ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Right Honorable Dato' Sri Muhammad Najib Tun Abdul Razak, the Prime Minister of Malaysia and patron of the WIEF Foundation, His Excellency Ikililu Tunaini, President of Comoros, His Excellency Tun Abdullah Haji Ahmad Badawi, the founder and patron of WIEF and former Malaysian Prime Minister, Honorable Tun Musa Hitam, Chairman of the World Islamic Economic Forum, ministers, distinguished guests, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Permit me to begin with fraternal greetings of amity and solidarity from the Bangsa Moro people in Mindanao to the organizers of the 8th World Islamic Forum, WIEF. Your invitation to this gathering of business leaders and prominent Islamic economic speakers is for me a rare privilege. It is a timely opportunity to project some business prospects as well as potential investments in Mindanao given the right Islamic institutional linkage. Last October 15, 2012, the Philippine government and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front, or MILF, representing the Bangsa Moro people in the south of the Philippines, sealed the framework agreement on the Bangsa Moro. This agreement is a manifestation of the changing trends in the relationship of peoples with the states where they are found. We acknowledge the efforts and the encouragement of His Excellency Prime Minister Dato' Sri Naguib Tun Razak of Malaysia and His Excellency President Benigno Simeon Aquino III of the Philippines to stay on the negotiation track until this milestone was achieved in the government MILF ongoing peace process. The Bangsa Moro people for centuries constitutes an independent nation, and only when the colonial powers handed them over to new created Philippine state that they lost their independent status. That was the reason why the Bangsa Moro Liberation Front, including the MILF, following the trend of the liberation movements in the early part of the last century, define their goal as political independence for the Bangsa Moro people. While separation from the Philippine state is the ideal on the part of the Bangsa Moro, and integration is desirable on the part of the Philippine government, but the MILF and the Philippine government are also conscious of the changing trend towards accommodation. In the framework agreement, the central government recognizes Bangsa Moro as the identity of our people and they remain citizens of the Philippines. In your form of government, which is ministerial, shall be established, which will be different from the unitary system of the central government in a defined territory. Powers are allocated to the central government and the Bangsa Moro government, and there are powers that both have to share. The framework agreement redefined the totality of relationship between the Bangsa Moro people and the Philippine government, which is described as asymmetric. This relationship preserves the territory of the Philippines from disintegration. At the same time, gives the Bangsa Moro people the power to govern themselves with less interference from the central government. The framework agreement does not only solve the armed conflict in Mindanao, but opens opportunities for the central government, the Bangsa Moro people, and the Muslim world. With peace that the framework agreement will bring to the country, foreign and domestic investment are expected to increase. A successful peace deal with the Bangsa Moro will certainly encourage other armed groups to pursue peace negotiation with the government, contributing to the stability of the country. A successful Bangsa Moro ministerial government will provide lessons for other regions to learn. And the savings that the government can generate from the absence of war will tremendously increase government capacity to deliver basic services to the Filipino people like education and health. The framework agreement opens opportunities for the Bangsa Moro people to govern themselves and rebuild their economy. The basic law will be drafted by a transition commission and will be transmitted to the Philippine Congress for legislative action. After it will be passed to Congress and approved by the Philippine President, the basic law will be submitted to the people of the territory for ratification, and then a new government will be established starting with the transition authority and then a regular government after the election in 2016. Organizing a new government for the Bangsamoro is not an easy task, especially so that what is to be built is different in form from the central government. There are Bangsamoro who are in government service, but their experience are basically administering a unitary system of government. The way to address this challenge is to train and retrain Bangsamoro fitted to the requirements of the Bangsamoro government. Once the Bangsamoro government is entrenched, expectedly in early 2015, the tasks of rebuilding the Bangsamoro economy begin. We hope that the rebuilding process will just be short and will be followed by sustained growth so that in the near future, no more Bangsamoro can be considered poor. This is possible if the Bangsamoro can have common vision for the future and can manage their resources efficiently. Although what is left to the Bangsamoro of their traditional territory is just one-fourth of their original homeland, but the resources found therein, if harnessed efficiently, can propel a regional economy to significant growth. In Liguasan Mars alone, for example, the natural gas deposit is tremendous. The government and the MILF have agreed to intensify development efforts for rehabilitation, reconstruction, and development of the Bangsamoro. Confronting the challenge, Malaysia Technical Cooperation Agency promised to continue its training and assistance to building institutions through the Bangsamoro Leadership and Management Institute and Bangsamoro Development Agency, or BDA, both products of the GRP and MILF talks. There is a willingness for MILF middle-level leadership to deliver services during the transformational phase in order to institute programs to address the needs of MILF combatants, internally displaced persons, and poverty-stricken communities. A negotiated political settlement typically attracts concrete multi-donor country support for conflict resolution and reconciliation. The parties agreed to establish a trust fund facility through which urgent support, recurrent and investment budget costs will be released progressively with efficiency, transparency, and accountability. The World Bank office has offered to set up support facility for the MILF eventually to enter into the formal economy. The Embassy of Japan in Manila signified a readiness to expand the existing socio-economic role of JBIRD into Bangsamoro Comprehensive Capacity Development Cooperation. The imminent needs of combatants, internally displaced families, and poor Bangsamoro families, which have to be addressed immediately in order that the framework agreement will be relevant to them, are livelihood, education for their children, health services, small infrastructure projects to protect them from floods, provide them potable water, and give them shelter. Current negotiation between the government and the MILF on wealth sharing and wealth creation focus on revenue generation from taxation and sources of revenue from exploration of natural resources found within the territorial base and internal waters of the Bangsamoro new political entity. On the investment side, the potential for new technology-based industries, agro-based expansions, mining, energy, and other sectors of services are immense. for initial economic trust, we believe that we are in the right direction to adopt clear criteria for eligible financing schemes, such as priority areas of capacity building, institutional strengthening, impact programs to address imbalances in development and infrastructures, specific policy measures inclusive of indigenous peoples, women, children, and internally displaced persons are not neglected. In broad context, the parties have recognized the need to attract multi-donor country support, assistance, and pledges to the normalization process. We can achieve a change dynamics in business environment and a desired quality of life, such as pursuit of sustainable livelihoods and productive activities. These are bright business prospects in Bangsamoro with the NEEDS principle of corporate governance. I should perhaps refer you to the most relevant general provisions on power sharing of the framework agreement. Broadly stated, the central government retains powers over common market and global trade, provided that the power to enter into economic agreement already allowed under existing law of the autonomous region will be transferred to the Bangsamoro. There is no other way to elevate the Bangsamoro people from the poverty cycle where loan sharks and pawn shops proliferate. They are the predators of ordinary people in the war-torn towns and conflict-affected areas in Mindanao. Many conventional banks and commercial banks or rural banks have expanded operation, but as depository branches without putting capital at risk. For wealth creation, a centralized Bangsamoro advisory body will be created to the apex of authority component to determine any riba-free issues relating to Islamic business operations and transactions. The framework agreement on the Bangsamoro opens opportunities for the Bangsamoro to live in peace and progress. But we want to do this, but we cannot do this alone. The tasks ahead are huge. We need support and guidance. We are committed to reverse the negative imagery of conflict-affected environment. Our strategic objective depends on looking for organizational tools to embark upon a corporate culture type of branding that signify Bangsamoro collective unity. MILF top leadership as principal role player for transformation to the business world has initially energized diplomacy for successfully negotiated conflict resolution. MILF revolutionary leaders have come a long way to struggle as key stakeholders to expect concrete peace dividends from the negotiation outcomes. We are convinced that a more predictable structural adjustment would come about from the framework agreement, which envisaged in the framework agreement. Leaders of the WIEF are in the best position to examine the capital risks required and the relative changes in the economic environment that would follow from more enterprising traders and investors. Before I conclude, let me express once again our deepest thanks to the organizer of the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum for allowing us to participate in this great endeavor. Likewise, we wish to take this opportunity to extend our invitation to our brothers and sisters in the Islamic world and elsewhere, to visit us in the Bangsamoro, perhaps to explore the possibilities to support us and our efforts under the current peace process, to rebuild our homeland and allow the Bangsamoro people to once again live in peace and progress, inshallah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you.
Thank you very much, His Excellency Al-Hajj Murad Ibrahim. What you have presented to us represents a very interesting template in terms of how a Muslim community, a minority Muslim community, can thrive and can prosper within the context of living in a nation governed by non-Muslims, but having a power-sharing arrangement with the Muslim community. That's certainly a very interesting model, and you have our best wishes, as well as whatever we can do to help the Bangsa Moro people to fight poverty and to succeed. Thank you. Our last but not least, by any means, speaker is His Excellency Tan Sri Dr. Muhammad Ali, President of IDB, and I hope he can share with us how IDB can assist the OIC countries, in particular in developing new business opportunities in the emerging economies. May I now invite His Excellency Dr. Ahmad Muhammad Ali to make his presentation.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Your Excellency Datu Seri Najib Tun Abdul Razzaq, Prime Minister of Malaysia. Your Excellency Special Representative of the President of the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. Your Excellency Special Representative of the Prime Minister of Qatar. Your Excellency Deputy Prime Minister of Singapore. Your Excellency Al-Hajj Murad Ibrahim, Chairman, Moro Islamic Liberation Front, Mindanao. Your Excellency Datu Abdul Ghani Uthman, Chief Minister of Johor State. Your Excellency Tun Musa Hitam, Chairman, World Islamic Economic Foundation. Your Excellencies, dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I wish to congratulate the government of Malaysia and the World Islamic Economic Foundation for successfully transforming this forum into a major global event. The forum is an excellent platform to enhance and forge cooperation in the Ummah for addressing urgent needs and emerging challenges and economic opportunities. To this end, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the Prime Minister of Malaysia and the leadership of the Foundation for their strong commitment to this Ummatic platform. I wish to reiterate that the Islamic Development Bank Group will continue to provide all the support needed to advance the activities of this forum. I also wish to congratulate all of you on the event of the new Hijra year, 1434 Hijra, and soon 2013. With the Hijra spirit, we should reflect the revisit our approach for collaboration as the source for global growth has shifted from the developed and large economies to emerging and developing countries. Your Excellencies, brothers and sisters, as many of you know, I am an avid admirer of the Malaysian development model. I have also been following closely the progress of Iskandar Malaysia Development Corridor project located here in the state of Johor. The Iskandar Malaysia project have strategically turned the ongoing global economic uncertainties into a growth opportunity, leveraging on regional economic growth potential. It is therefore a demonstration that developing economies can and should create their own future. Uncertain time is an opportunity for those who know and who desire to change the fate of their nations. I therefore wish to congratulate Your Excellency, the Prime Minister of Malaysia, Dato Seri Najib, for your visionary leadership in shaping Malaysia into a high-income, innovative economy. Excellencies, brothers and sisters, the theme of this forum, Changing Trends, New Opportunities, in this context, I propose to focus on co-deployment in this age of innovation-driven economy. Wherever the private sector assumes the lead role and the public sector nurtures innovations and entrepreneurship, especially targeting the youth, I wish to suggest that we emphasize on the adaptation, utilization, and deployment of the most advanced technological and services that is being deployed in the developed countries. The approach is therefore not about co-creation, that's to say, focusing on discovering frontier technologies, but in co-deployment of advanced technologies. The co-deployment approach, in my view, is an unrealized dimension towards building a high-tech innovation-driven economy for the developing and least developed economies. However, I would caution that co-deployment is not simply about the conventional technology transfer. And we must certainly be cautious of it being used for technology dumping. Through co-deployment, we can inevitably co-create. A number of our member countries, including Malaysia, are actively pursuing and building institutions and programs for the innovation and knowledge-based economy. As we embrace the innovation-driven economy, we should promote value-based innovation. The global financial industry and its crisis have taught us that innovation have to be value-based. The Islamic finance and Islamic banking industry have much to offer on this aspect. In pursuing the co-deployment approach in context of the innovation-driven economy, the private sector, particularly the entrepreneurs and the youth group, is expected to assume the lead role. Collectively, we need to systematically nurture and grow co-deployment policy, programs, institutions, and firms. Further, we need to coordinate our collective global network to tap and partner with global sources of new development opportunities, both in the member countries, but more importantly, in the more advanced economies and centers of excellence all over the world. Your Excellencies, dear brothers and sisters, the co-deployment approach is a modality within the Islamic Development Bank Group Reverse Linkage Program of Islamic Development Bank Group Member Country Partnership Strategy, or MCPS. The MCPS for Malaysia was launched by Your Excellency Dato Seri Najib early this year. I am pleased to state that since the launching of Malaysia MCPS, we have been actively pursuing reverse linkage between Malaysia and Tunisia in the area of Islamic finance and halal industry development, between Malaysia and Afghanistan in the area of higher education, between Malaysia and Uganda in the area of city service reform and development planning and monitoring. In the area of Hajj management, through the IDB Group Private Sector Arm, that is the Islamic Corporation for Development of Private Sector, ICD, we are now collaborating with Tabun Hajj Malaysia to promote the model for adoption in other member countries and non-member countries too. I therefore wish to record IDB Group's sincere gratitude to the people and the government of Malaysia to have assumed a pioneering role in this effort. I believe the reverse linkage modality, and within that, the co-deployment, can be an effective channel for supporting Malaysia's global venturing efforts too. Building upon the institutional infrastructure and experience of Malaysia and Qatar in regard to transforming their economies to innovation driven, and with keen interest, if Your Excellency the Prime Minister of Malaysia and His Excellency the Prime Minister of Qatar, through his special representative, to further enhance WIF. I wish to humbly suggest to Your Excellency Prime Minister of Malaysia and His Excellency Prime Minister of Qatar, through his special representative, my neighbor here, together with the Islamic Development Bank Group, to kindly consider establishing relevant knowledge sharing programs, taking in consideration the co-deployment aspect. Further, I'm also pleased to announce that the Islamic Development Bank Group has made this year, 1434 Hijra, as the year to promote innovation for development. The Islamic Development Bank Group will be organizing a global symposium on innovation for development during the coming annual meeting of our Board of Governors, which will be held, inshallah, in Dushanbe, Tajikistan, this coming May 2013. Innovation will be the theme of the Islamic Development Bank Group coming annual meeting in Dushanbe. We hope to deliberate further on how we can commoditize innovation to the varying development aspirations and conditions in our member countries. Many of the outcomes from the innovation forums of our member countries, like the recently concluded World Innovation Forum held last month in Kuala Lumpur, can be further consolidated with the focus in innovation for development, for which, in the spirit of Hijra, let us enhance our cooperation and collaboration. Your Excellencies, dear brothers and sisters, in conclusion, I wish to again thank the Prime Minister, the people of Malaysia, and the World Islamic Economic Foundation for inviting the Islamic Development Bank Group to this very important forum. I hope my proposal for co-deployment can help inspire new discussion in this very important forum. I wish this forum profound success, inshallah. Thank you all. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I wish to thank His Excellency Dr. Ahmad Muhammad Ali for his address, in particular for his emphasis on the need for us to develop an innovation-driven economy, and also for making a specific suggestion how we can move forward, particularly between Malaysia, Qatar, and the Development Bank. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the end of our session. I regret to tell you that due to time constraints, we will not be able to take questions from the floor. The addresses made by the respective leaders this morning have provided us with a wide spectrum of perspectives and very useful insight that I'm sure you found very interesting. I hope that we have all benefited immensely from the sharing of their views, and I wish to thank all of them for their contribution. Let us show our deep appreciation for what they have contributed. Thank you. I like to call this that this session has ended, and pass on to the master ceremony. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Prime Minister, and also to all the distinguished leaders. And ladies and gentlemen, we now like to invite the Honorable Prime Minister and all the distinguished leaders for a group photograph, if you would like to kindly step forward to mark this auspicious occasion, this historic event. There you are, ladies and gentlemen. Let's hear a big round of applause for the Honorable Prime Minister and also our distinguished leaders. Honorable Prime Minister and our distinguished leaders, we'd like to remain we'd like to invite you to remain standing for the next program, where we'll be witnessing the exchange of documents, confirmation of signing of memoranda of understanding and agreements which have been signed earlier in conjunction with the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum here. And it will be done by way of exchange of documents or merely by handshakes. And ladies and gentlemen, as the WIEF provides business connectivity and opportunity for networking among global business, financial and political leaders, we will now witness 6 partnerships through memorandum of agreements and memorandum of understandings forged in conjunction with the 8th WIEF. And you may like to know, ladies and gentlemen, that the total value of the 6 agreements is estimated at Ringgit Malaysia 28 billion. And first is the memorandum of understanding. Yes, a big hand to them. A memorandum of understanding between Malaysian Industry Government Group for High Technology, or MITE, and Nano Malaysia Berhad. And the MOU will see the two parties collaborating in identifying potential offset program recipients for nanotechnology-based industries from various sectors. May we now invite Professor Emeritus Dr. Engineer Zawawi Ismail, Chairman of Nano Malaysia Berhad, and Mr. Muhammad Yusof bin Sulaiman, President and Chief Executive Officer of MITE, to exchange documents. Congratulations and thank you to Professor Dr. Engineer Zawawi and Sheikh Muhammad Yusuf Sulaiman. Next, ladies and gentlemen, is the subscription and shareholders agreement between Sunway City Sdn Bhd and Iskandar Assets Sdn Bhd. The joint venture agreement formalized is for the shareholders and subscription agreement for the incorporation of a joint venture company between Iskandar Assets Sdn Bhd and Sunway City Sdn Bhd, the wholly owned subsidiaries of Iskandar Investment Bhd, the catalytic developer of Iskandar Malaysia and Sunway Bhd, one of Malaysia's leading conglomerates. We'd like to invite Datuk Syed Muhammad Syed Ibrahim, President CEO of Iskandar Investment Group, and Mr. Ho Hon Sang, Managing Director of Sunway Group, on stage for the exchange of documents. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are also happy to announce that UEM Land Holdings Berhad will be exchanging four documents or sealing four agreements here today. Firstly, a memorandum of understanding on the development of China Mall, a trade and exhibition center in Nusa Jaya, Iskandar, Malaysia. And the documents will be exchanged between UEM Land Berhad and China Mall Holdings Private Limited. And for this, we'd like to invite Yang Berbahagia Datuk Wan Abdullah Wan Ibrahim, Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer of UEM Land Holdings Berhad, and Mr. Dean Wang, Chairman of China Mall Holdings Private Limited. Thank you, and we'd like to invite Datuk Wan Abdullah to remain on stage for the next exchange. Coming up is the collaborative agreement between UEM Land Berhad, Iskandar Investment Berhad and Telekom Malaysia Berhad on the provision of communication and ICT infrastructure and telecommunication services to realise the smart and connected Nusa Jaya aspirations. May we call on Datuk Syed Muhammad bin Syed Ibrahim once again, Chief Executive Officer of Iskandar Investment Berhad, and Datuk Sri Zamzam Zairani Muhammad Issa, Chief Executive Officer of Telekom Malaysia Berhad, onto the stage. Congratulations, and we'd like to request Datuk Wan Abdullah, Datuk Syed Muhammad, as well as Datuk Zamzam Zairani to remain on stage for the next exchange. Next is a collaborative agreement between UEM Land Berhad, Iskandar Investment Berhad, Telekom Malaysia Berhad, Centios Company Limited of South Korea and Cisco System International BV on the opportunities available for providing smart city and smart building infrastructure and services, the establishment of a managed services operating company and the establishment of a global innovation center to realize the smart and connected Nusa Jaya aspirations. We now have Mr. Yuri Wahab, Managing Director of Cisco Systems Malaysia, also Mr. Hong Kwan Song, Chief Executive Officer of Centios Company Limited. Congratulations and thank you, Datuk Syed Muhammad, Datuk Zamzam Zairani, Mr. Yuri Wahab and also Mr. Hong. Yang Berbahagia Datuk Wan Abdullah will still remain on stage for the final exchange. Yes, finally, a joint venture agreement on the development of a motorsport city in Gerbang, Nusa Jaya, located in Nusa Jaya, Iskandar, Malaysia. UEM Land Berhad has entered into a joint agreement with Fast Track Autosports Private Limited. Without further ado, we now call upon Mr. Peter Lim, shareholder of Fast Track Autosports Private Limited, to exchange documents with Datuk Wan Abdullah. We'd like to invite Datuk Wan and Peter Lim to please remain on stage as next to commemorate this joint venture, and also in conjunction with this ceremony here today, we'd like to invite a very special guest onto the stage to present a memento to the Honourable Prime Minister of Malaysia. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Lewis Hamilton, Formula One driver from McLaren team, to present a special memento to the Honourable Prime Minister. There you are, ladies and gentlemen, more exciting times for racing here in Johor Bahru. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the segment and also concludes the official opening ceremony of the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum. Thank you once again, Honorable Dato' Sri Mohamad Najib, Prime Minister of Malaysia, for being here to officially open this forum. We'd also like to record our sincere appreciation to our distinguished guests for being here today. Well, in the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, please take note that lunch for all delegates will be served at level one, which is two floors down from here. Also, please kindly leave the translation or interpretation devices on your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, may we now call upon our host, the Honorable Tun Musa Hitam, to invite and accompany the Honorable Prime Minister of Malaysia and our distinguished guests to adjourn for a tour of the WIEF exhibition, followed by the leaders' luncheon. Once again, a special announcement for tonight's gala dinner. We'd like to invite all delegates to the gala dinner, and we have buses transporting everybody from here, the Pusada Johor International Convention Centre, to Kota Istana beginning at 5:30 p.m. And we have a very exciting program lined up for you at the Kota Iskandar in Nusa Jaya, and you will also get an opportunity to visit the new city. And members of the press, kindly check out the press conference schedule at the media center on level 2, and we look forward to your support. To all delegates, please take note that the first session after lunch, which is a global economic outlook, world in influx, leadership in changing times, with a keynote address by the Honorable Tun Abdullah Haji Mat Badawi, will begin at 1:45 here in this hall. Thank you all for your kind presence and support. Sekian. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh.